Good afternoon, everybody. Today, the afternoon session of this introductory class, I am going to tell you about the industrial chemistry. This is the sixth chapter of applied science. As you know, this is the last chapter in applied science. In this chapter, we have these topics, that is electrolysis, corrosion, batteries, fuel cells, metallurgy, polymers, composite materials, solutions, pH of solutions. These are the topics in the industrial chemistry unit 6 of applied science, in which already one of the topics is been covered, that is electrolysis. And now in this session, I am going to cover the topics. They are batteries, fuel cells, metallurgy, polymers, composite materials, and solutions. These are the topics I am going to engage today in this session of interactive class. As from the question paper point of view, if you see from these topics, we get from part A, from the question paper, we get two questions of 2 marks. Two questions of 2 marks, that is 4 marks. In part B, there is 4 questions of 5 marks, that is 20 marks. And in part C, there is 1 question of 6 marks. Totally 30 marks. This industrial chemistry covers these marks from the question paper. So now, from the topic as I have told, I will start the topics of batteries. Batteries. As we know, battery is a source of electrical energy which can be carried from one point to another point. In this topic on batteries, we are going to study the concept of batteries, and types of batteries, and their applications. So these are the things we are going to cover from this topic on batteries. So when we talk about the concept of the batteries, already we know that battery is something you have seen, one of the cell like this. This is a cell which is used for the purpose of current, having positive terminal and negative terminal. So this is called as a cell. Such type of cells joined together either in series or in parallel forms a battery. So in such type of cells, there is a production of current or movement of electrons takes place. The movement of electron takes place by means of electrolysis. So already we have seen the meaning of electrolysis, in which an electrochemical cell is required. Electrochemical cell, as you know, consists of an electrolyte and two electrodes. One is positive electrode and another one is a negative electrode. Chemical reaction takes place here or in this electrolyte, and then electrons are liberated which are moving in a external circuit. Electrons are liberated and moving in a external circuit. So this is the electrochemical cell. Such type of cell is here, which is made so that it can be portable one. So electrolysis is the main thing that takes place here also in the cell. So such type of cell will have, is also known as a galvanic cell. Galvanic cell, and it converts, is a device which converts the chemical energy contained in it as active material directly into electrical energy by means of electrochemical oxidation and reduction. So here electrochemical oxidation and reduction takes place. So at the anode oxidation takes place, liberating the electron. And at the cathode, reduction reaction takes place where this electron reunite with the ion, and this electron which is liberated will move through the external circuit producing an electric current. So batteries of one or more electrochemical cells electrically connected in an appropriate series or parallel arrangement to provide the required operating voltage and current levels. So these batteries are classified into two types, that is primary battery and secondary battery. These primary battery, the reaction occurs only once, and after use over a period of time, battery becomes dead and cannot be reused. So after a period of time, we have to throw that battery. It cannot be reused. So if the most familiar example of this type of cell that we use in the transistor radio are clocks. So in transistor radio or clocks, we use this type of primary batteries. These primary batteries, zinc contained and also acts as anode, and carbon graphite rod acts as a cathode. It is surrounded by a powder manganese dioxide. I am going to show you this cross section of a cell little later. So a battery, a zinc contained cell consists of a carbon graphite rod acts as a cathode, and zinc contained acts as a anode. The space between the electrodes is filled by paste of ammonium chloride, NH4Cl, and zinc chloride. The electrode reactions are little bit complex. Anyhow, what happens at the electrodes, I'll just show by a simple reaction on the board. See, at the anode, what happens? The zinc will liberate an electron and becomes Zn plus. So this is an oxidation reaction which takes place at the anode. So the liberated electron will combine with the manganese oxide MnO2 plus this electron plus water will give rise to, this is Mn2O2 it will become, adding with the electron, Mn2O2 it will become Mn2O2. It will become Mn2O2, and of course the water is liberated again. So this reaction, which is taking place at the anode and at the cathode in a battery, so a little bit complex reaction takes place, and thus the liberated electron do not move through the electrolyte, but it will move to the external circuit. So thus the electron liberated will moving, producing the electric current. So we can visualize this in this animation in my next slide. You can see this here. We have a cathode, electrolyte, and an anode. So you can see that at the anode there is a liberation of electrons taking place. These electrons move through the external circuit. While thus moving, they will glow the bulb and move towards the cathode. In both the diagrams, you can see how the electrons are moving and glowing that bulb from the anode to cathode. This is a cross section of a primary shell shown. So you can see there is a zinc negative terminal which acts as a anode, and a carbon positive terminal which acts as a cathode. So the in between that anode and a cathode, there is a electrolyte such as carbon and manganese dioxide mixture. So there is a paste and a separator is also placed in order to accommodate these electrolytes. So this complete thing forms a dry cell. So through this dry cell, whenever the circuit is connected, the electrons will be liberated from the zinc negative terminal and move towards the anode. So while moving, they glow the light or bulb, so which is in between the circuit. So this is how a primary cell works. Next one is a secondary battery. So secondary battery is a collection of cells which can be recharged and reused after the discharge, are called secondary cells. So collection of such cells forms a secondary battery. As I already told that a battery is a collection of two or more cells in the form of series or parallel. So secondary batteries are having very good advantage that they can be used again and again. So once they get discharged, then they can be charged from the external current. Again, they are ready to use. Like this, they can be used again and again so that there is no loss. The chemical reaction is reversed during the charging of that battery. So secondary batteries recharge by passing current through it so that it can be used again. Secondary batteries undergo large number of discharge and charging cycles. The best example for secondary batteries is lead storage battery, commonly used in automobiles and in UPS. You might have seen that in automobiles, they use this battery in order to get the ignition. So whenever we start a vehicle, the current from the battery is used to ignite and then the vehicle starts. So in UPS also, during the external current, the UPS gets charged. So whenever there is a power down, so whenever the current goes, we get the current from the UPS, that is through the battery. This is a secondary battery. So some more examples of secondary batteries are lead acid battery, lithium batteries, and so on. Here, this slide, I've shown you the cross section of a lead acid battery and a single cell of a rechargeable battery or cell, where it is a lead anode is lead dioxide, PbO2, and cathode is lead, Pb. In between that, we have an electrolyte H2SO4, sulfuric acid, that to be
a dilute sulfuric acid. So during the process of electrolysis, electrons are liberated, moves from anode towards the cathode, and this there is a voltage is developed. So this cell works, and then when it gets discharged completely discharged means there is no more current available, then this can be charged. Such type of small cells are arranged in series or parallel in a container to give the battery. I have shown a lead acid battery. So this is a secondary battery. As we now understood that primary batteries are batteries that cannot be reused after a long use, whereas secondary batteries are those which can be used again and again. Whenever we recharge the battery, it is ready to give again the current. So thus, this is a secondary battery and a primary battery. So that is the simple concept of the batteries and the different types of the batteries. So concept of the battery is to produce the electric charge and by means of electrolysis. That is the concept of the battery. So types of batteries are primary battery and secondary battery. And how, where all we use these batteries? You are very well known that where all we are using these batteries. So alkaline batteries are used in digital cameras, handheld games, torches, and wall clocks. So we have seen this alkaline batteries. They are all called as alkaline batteries. Zinc carbon batteries are used in flashlight, remote controls, toys, and table clocks. So such batteries are used in these places. Mercury batteries are used to run real-time clock in CPU on computer. So in computer, there is a real-time clock which is run by means of a mercury battery. Lithium and silver oxide batteries are having long life and very expensive. These are used in military and submarines. Since they are very expensive, they are used in specific place like military and submarines. They are made up of lithium and silver. Anyhow, silver oxide and lithium, they are costly metals. Therefore, these batteries are expensive. Commonly used batteries, that is secondary batteries, that such as lead acid batteries, are used in UPS, ignition system of automobiles. This I already told you. So battery is used as power source in solar lighting also. So in solar lighting, during the daytime, the solar light is converted into electrical energy. That electrical energy is used to charge the battery. During the night time, there is no sun. Therefore, this battery will use the current for the lighting purpose. And they are used as power source in many electronic devices. So as you know, that power source for mobile phones, we use these batteries. So there are these are some of the applications of batteries. So in this batteries topic, you should understand the concept of batteries, types of batteries, and their applications. This is one topic. The next topic is fuel cells. Fuel cells. As the name indicates, this is a cell. This is also a cell. Fuel cells run by a fuel. So in this topic on fuel cells, we are going to study the definition of fuel cell, and we try to understand what is a fuel cell, and then mentioning the types of fuel cells and their advantages.
So as I already seen, told you that batteries are used to carry the current. Similarly, fuels also will develop the current. But the principle of fuel cells is little bit different from the batteries or cells, galvanic cells. So in fuel cells, same thing will take place. That is, electrolysis will take place, but a bit different manner. So here, the main thing which required for a fuel cell is hydrogen, then an electrode, then an electrolyte, then again an electrode and oxygen. So oxygen and hydrogen are abundantly available. So how do this takes place? So this also, as I told, fuel cell is also a electrochemical cell that converts chemical energy in the form of fuel into electricity through electrochemical reaction. So hydrogen is a fuel, and with oxygen or oxidizing agent such as methane, propane, methanol, even gasoline and diesel can be used as a fuel. So here in a fuel cell, that is the fuel cell. So I repeat that fuel cell is an electrochemical cell that converts chemical energy in the form of fuel into electricity through an electrochemical reaction of hydrogen fuel with oxygen. So hydrogen fuel reacts with the oxygen here or other oxidizing agents. So fuel cell made up of three adjacent segments: the anode, electrolyte and the cathode. Two chemical reactions occur at the interface of three different segments. The net result of the two reactions is that fuel is consumed, water or carbon dioxide is liberated, and thus electrical energy or electrical current is generated. So as you can see in the figure, that from one side the hydrogen atoms are entering inside and it comes towards the catalyst. So when it comes to the catalyst, they are divided into hydrogen ions and electrons. So electrons cannot move through the electrolyte, only hydrogen ions can move through the electrolyte. But electrons are made to pass through an external circuit and reaches the another electrode. By the time the hydrogen atoms comes there, combine with this hydrogen ions, combines with this electron, become hydrogen, and then they are added with the oxygen to form water as a bypass or byproduct or an exhaust. So this is how a electro fuel cell works. So what happens is that, suppose this is a hydrogen H2, and here is a catalyst. So this H2 cannot pass through this one membrane here, say an electrode. What happens is that this hydrogen will split into H plus ions and electrons. These H plus ions can very easily move through this electrolyte. Here is an electrolyte. This is an electrolyte. They can move through this electrolyte. H plus ions will move through this electrolyte. Whereas electrons are made to pass through the external circuit. When they come, these electrons will be moving like this. They come to the second electrode and they combine with the hydrogen and becomes hydrogen ion and becomes H2. By the time there is oxygen which is combining with this hydrogen, liberating water. So the external circuit, the electrons are flowing. This is a current, electric current.
So that's what I have shown in an animation of my slide, where you can see the hydrogen, neutral hydrogen atom is splitting into the electrons and hydrogen ions. These hydrogen ions are moving towards the catalyst or towards the oxygen. By the time electrons are moving from the external circuit, glowing the bulb and reaches the second electrode and combine with the hydrogen, hydrogen ion becomes hydrogen, which combines further with the oxygen to form water. So these electrons which are coming out will be generating the electric current. So an electrochemical cell is the energy of the of a reaction between fuel such as liquid hydrogen and an oxidant such as oxygen is converted directly continuously into electrical energy. So the advantage of this cell is that it will give out electrical energy continuously as the hydrogen is supplied. As long as we supply the hydrogen, that is fuel, the cell continuously gives this electrical energy. There are different type of fuel cells. So type of fuel cell is based on the type of fuel that is used and the electrolyte that is used. So common thing is oxygen, which is required for all the types of fuel cells. Few types of fuel cells I have listed, and their diagrams also is given in my slides. So types of fuel cells, number one is polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell, called as PEM, polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell. So here proton exchange membrane is there, so where the protons will exchange, and proton means that is H plus ions, protons means H plus ions, they will combine further with the electron and becomes hydrogen, and further they combine with the oxygen atoms to form the water. This is an animation of a direct methanol fuel cell, in which methanol is used as a fuel which is producing the hydrogen, and which is in turn act with the combine with the oxygen, and these electrons once again will be moving from the external circuit, glowing the bulb. That means there we can draw the electrical energy. So this is how the second type of fuel cell, that is methanol solution fuel cell, is there. So in which we can see a small reaction also here. CH3OH is an ethanol, methanol, which combines with water, gives rise to carbon dioxide and six electrons and six hydrogen ions. These will take place at the anode. This reaction takes place at the anode. Once again, this is an oxidation reaction. As we know, there is a liberation of electron takes place. Of course, carbon dioxide is also released along with the hydrogen ions. These hydrogen ions combine with they recombine with the electrons further with the oxygen to give a water molecule, that is 3H2O. So overall reaction that is taking place at the cathode. So this you can see in this slide. So this is a direct methanol fuel cell. Next one is alkaline fuel cell. So here OH, an alkaline, is used as a electrolyte. So once again, the same thing, hydrogen and oxygen is required. So hydrogen once again liberates, split into electrons and hydrogen ion for move towards the oxygen, combine. So electrons will be moving from the external circuit, producing the electric current. So this is an alkaline fuel cell. So next fuel cell is phosphoric acid fuel cell. phosphoric acid once again acts as a electrolyte. So once again, we require hydrogen and oxygen. Anyhow, in any type of a fuel cell, if you take, we require hydrogen and oxygen, which is abundantly available in nature. So this is molten carbonate fuel cell. So once again, the molten carbonate is used as a fuel in this and an electrolyte. This is solid oxide fuel cell. So SOFC, it is called as. So oxide O is oxide is used as a electrolyte here in this solid oxide fuel cell. This is a reversible fuel cell. So where we can once again reverse the reaction, as in case of batteries we have seen. So these are some of the types of fuel cells. So fuel cells are different types based on the their electrolyte and the input fuel that is used. Anyhow, overall, when you see a fuel cell, it requires hydrogen atoms and oxygen atoms. So these hydrogen atoms will be split into ions, and they move through the electrolyte. From the external circuit, the electrons will be moving, and they come once again towards the second electrode, combine with the hydrogen, become hydrogen. This hydrogen will react with the oxygen to produce the water. This is the main thing that takes place in a fuel cell. Let us see what are the advantages of these fuel cells. So once again, fuel cell is similar to a galvanic cell, as we have seen, or batteries, which is used to produce the electric current to carry from one point to another point. So fuel cells have various advantages compared to conventional power sources. Conventional power sources are engines or combustion engines, internal combustion engines, and batteries. Although some of fuel cells attributes are some valid for some applications, most advantages are more general. They are, fuel cells are higher efficiency than diesel or gas engines. So as we know, the diesel or gas engines are also producing this electric current. They are less efficient when compared with the fuel cells. Most fuel cells, number two, most fuel cells operate silently compared to internal combustion engines, and they are ideally situated for the use of buildings such as hospitals. So this diesel or gas engines, which is producing this electric current, will make more noise. So they are not suitable in places such as hospitals. Therefore, in such places, we can use this fuel cells. The third advantage is fuel cells eliminate pollution caused by burning fossil fuels. So by burning fossil fuels, we get a lot of pollutions. So here we are burning hydrogen. Therefore, then less pollution takes place. And of course, the byproduct here is a water, which can be used for different purpose. Fourth advantage of fuel cell, if the hydrogen comes from the electrolysis of water driven by renewable energy, then using fuel cells eliminate such as dangerous effects such as greenhouse effect, so which caused the very high environmental pollution over a whole cycle. So fuel cell avoid this greenhouse effect. So that is why it is advantageous to use these fuel cells. The fifth advantage is that fuel cells do not need conventional fuels such as oil or gas, and can therefore reduce economic dependence on oil producing countries. So as we know, that oil producing countries are grabbing lot of amount for selling these oils, which are used for the different purpose. So by using fuel cells, we can avoid this oil or gas, because in fuel cells, we are mostly using hydrogen and oxygen. Therefore, hydrogen and oxygen is available everywhere. So thus, we do not depend on the oil producing countries when you use this fuel cells. That is the fifth advantage of using this fuel cells. The sixth advantage is, since hydrogen can be produced anywhere, there is a water and source of power generation. A fuel can be distributed and loss does not have to be grid dependent. So we cannot have grid dependent. So wherever we want, we can produce this hydrogen, because the main source of fuel cell, main source of hydrogen is water. From water we can produce this hydrogen. That is the sixth advantage of fuel cells. And seventh advantage is, the use of stationary fuel cells generate power at the point of use allows for decentralized power grid and is potential more stable. So their potential is more stable, thus we can use fuel cells. Fuel cells, once again, are of two types. When we take low temperature fuel cells as well as high temperature fuel cells. So the eighth advantage is that low temperature fuel cells have low heat transmission, which makes ideal for military applications. So in military applications, we can use these fuel cells so that it do not transmit more heat. So higher temperature fuel cells also are there. They produce high grade process heat along with electricity and are well suited for combination of applications such as combined heat and power for residential use. Wherever we want combined heat and the power, we can use these high power fuel cells. That is all we study in fuel cells. In fuel cells, what is very important to know is that what is a fuel cell, that is a definition of the fuel cell, and naming different types of fuel cells, and then the advantages of fuel cells. So the next topic is metallurgy. Metallurgy. So in this metallurgy topic, we are going to study definitions of definitions that is involved in the metallurgy, that is ore, mineral, flux, slag and alloys. So basically, as we already know, that metallurgy is a branch of chemistry which deals with the, or branch of science which deals with the study of production of metals, purification and properties of metals. So how do the metals can be extracted from its ore, and a different process that is involved in extracting the metal from the ore is all studied in metallurgy. But we are not going to study in detail how ore is extracted, used to extract the metals. So we study only basic things in this metallurgy topic. So metallurgy is the branch of science and technology which deals with the study of production, purification and properties of the metals. So we study some of the definitions, such as ore, mineral, definitions such as ore, mineral, flux, slag, alloys. So we are going to study these things in our next continuation topic. So ore is a naturally occurring solid material from which a metal or valuable minerals can be extracted profitably. So that is called as a ore. It is a natural occurring solid. Most of the metals in nature do not obtain in pure form. They are formed either in the form of an oxide or in the form of a sulfide. So these are the two forms of a metal. So because pure metal, most of the pure metals do not form exactly how do we use, but they are in the form of oxide or sulfide, which is known as a ore. So from the ore, they have to be extracted. So in the diagram, in the slide, I have shown some of the ores. That is, hematite is one example of ore by which we can extract iron. Bauxite is another ore which is extracted, by which we can extract aluminium. Cuprite is another type of ore by which we can extract copper. So copper can be extracted from cuprite. And another example of ore is zincite, by which we can extract zinc. So all these ores are not in the pure form, they are impure form. They are mixed with, they are found in the earth's crust in the impure form. They are further used by different process, which we call it as metallurgy, to extract the pure metal. That is a ore. I repeat, a naturally occurring solid material from which a metal or valuable mineral can be extracted profitably. So that is a ore. Next is a mineral. A mineral, a naturally occurring inorganic substance obtained by mining and containing the metal in free state or combined state, are called minerals. So some of the metals are found in their free state only, as we use. For example, rubies, diamonds, emeralds, metals like gold, silver, copper, lead, sometimes iron and zinc also. These metals can be found in free state also. So they are called as minerals. So when we get a metal in free state, it is called as a mineral. Sometimes it is combined also. Next is next term is a flux. As I told that a ore is mixture of the oxides of metals and some other earth materials are combined in it to form a ore. So flux is a chemical substance added to the concentrated ore during the process of extraction of pure metal from its ore at high temperature in order to remove gangue in the form of fusible slag. So flux is a chemical which is added to the ore to remove some of the impurities, which is known as gangue. Gangue are the impurities like sand, mud, etc. present in ore. So to remove these things, we add some chemicals. So these chemicals are known as flux. So they are added to the concentrated ore. So the concentrated ore is one which is having more metal and less impurities. So it is one stage of metallurgy where we add this flux, which can be remove this gangue. As you know, gangue already told that is impurities like sand, mud present in this red. Next term is used mostly in metallurgy is slag, the easily fusible material. So it can be easily fusible, soluble, and not soluble in molten metal, but it is soluble while it is removed, which form a flux reacts with the gango to have a slag. So as you told, we add chemicals. These chemicals react with gango, forms a slag, which is fusible material. So we have shown here in the diagram how a slag appears like. So these metals, when they are extracted during different process of metallurgy, after different process, these pure metals are obtained, which can be used in our day-to-day life. So while using these metals, they have lot of disadvantages. So these metals, pure metals, are highly corrodible. They get very soon corroded, and they are very not so hard. And to make this material usable, we make an alloy. So alloy is required to make in order to use that material or metal. So it is a metal. Alloy is also a metal composed of two or more elements, of which at least one is a metal, is called as alloy. So there should be one metal and two or more elements, maybe metals only, added to form a alloy. So also alloys are metallic materials consisting of two or more elements combined in such a way that they cannot be readily separated by physical means. More than 90% of the metals are used in the form of alloys. So for example, iron cannot be used directly, so we make an alloy. Similarly, aluminium cannot be used directly for all purpose, therefore we make an alloy of aluminium. Similarly, copper cannot be used directly or as a pure metal in some situations, so therefore we use a copper alloy. So some metals like gold, platinum, they are in the pure form. They do not undergo lot of loss when they are exposed to the environment. That means they do not corrode. Therefore, they can be used as such. So we do not make the alloy of gold or alloy of silver or alloy of platinum. We make the alloy of iron, alloy of copper, alloy of. The purpose of making alloys, the main purpose of making alloy is to make the metal more hard than pure metal. As I told, pure metals are not so hard. So to make them more hard, we have to add some other materials so that they become hard, which we call it as a alloy. So thus, to make the metal more hard than pure metal, we have to make a alloy. So next one is to make the metal more resistant to corrosion than pure metal. So as I told, pure metals such as iron, copper, aluminium will get corroded as soon as they are exposed to the environment. So that to resist that metal from the corrosion, we have to make the alloy of that metal. Thus, alloys are corrosion resistant. And to lower the melting point, we require alloys. So enhance the better tensile strength, we use these alloys. To provide better castability, to make different shapes, we use these alloys. Here are listed some of the compositions and uses of alloys. So the name of the alloy, composition that is there, properties, and where we are using these alloys. The first alloy that I have taken is a Babbitt metal. So Babbitt metal is a alloy of tin, we can tell. Tin is a metal which is required to make an alloy for the use. So in Babbitt metal, we have tin of 90%, antimony 7%, and copper 3%. So all these things mixed together to form a Babbitt metal, which is an alloy of tin. So the property of this alloy is that low measure of friction with steel. It is having a low measure of friction with steel. Therefore, it is ideal for making the bearings. That is the use of Babbitt metal. So the next most commonly used alloy is bronze. So is bronze is an alloy of copper, in which 90% of copper is there and some 10% of tin is added to it to become bronze. It is hard and strong, does not corrode easily, and has a shiny surface. So it is having shiny surface, it is hard and strong than copper and not corroded easily. So that is the property of this alloy bronze. It is used to build statues and monuments. As you know, statues and monuments are always exposed to the environment. Therefore, they should be very hard and strong, and they should not corrode easily. And bronze is used to make swords, metals, artistic materials. That is the use of bronze. So next alloy is a brass. Of course, this is also a alloy of copper. So in which 70% of copper is there and 30% of zinc is there. So take 70% of copper and 30% of zinc, they combine to form this brass. This is harder than copper. So it is used in making the musical instruments and kitchenwares. So kitchenwares are made up of brass because they are hard than copper. So next important alloy is a steel. So steel we use at many places. So which is a alloy of iron. So in which 90% of iron is there and 1% of carbon is there. The property of steel is that it is hard and strong. So 99% of iron we are using here and 1% of carbon we are using. So just by adding 1% of carbon, it will become harder than the iron, steel. Harder than iron, that is steel. So it is used, as we know, in construction of buildings and bridges, in building of cars and railway tracks. So we use this steel. Next one is stainless steel. So this is also widely used nowadays for many domestic purpose. It is also a alloy of iron, in which 74% of iron is there, 8% of carbon is there, and 18% of chromium is there. This is shiny, strong, and does not rust, light in weight, and strong also. It is used to make surgical instrument, and for most of the domestical purpose, we are using this type, this steel. Duralumin is a aluminium of, it is a alloy of aluminium, in which 93% of aluminium is there and 3% of copper is there, 3% of magnesium is there and 1% of manganese is there. So this is light and strong. It is used to make the bodies of the planes and bullet trains. So these are some of the uses of alloys. In this topic of metallurgy, we have studied the different terms that are involved in metallurgy, such as ore, mineral, flux, slag, alloys, and purpose of making these alloys, and some of the alloys and their composition, their properties, and their uses. Next one topic is polymers. Polymers is our next topic. So polymer, by the name itself, it tells that poly means many,
MERS means that is the monomer, that is single one. So adding most of the monomers, it will form a polymer. So in polymers, we can see some of the polymers such as CH2 double bond CH2. This is a unsaturated hydrocarbon known as ethylene. It is a ethylene. So with the catalyst, with the help of catalyst, temperature and pressure, this will form a saturated hydrocarbon. So the ring double bond like this, more number of ethylene will combine to form a macromolecule. This is a monomer. This is a polymer. So polymer is formed by means of a monomer. Number of monomers joined together to form a polymer. So polymers are compounds of high molecular weight. This is having a very high molecular weight, derived either by addition of smaller molecules as polyethylene, as it is called polyethylene, by condensation of smaller molecules with the elimination of water is like a nylon. So this is this becomes a polyethylene. Polyethylene, generally known as polyethylene. So as you know, polyethylene is used in many places, in domestic places like polyethylene bags, all those things are made up of this polyethylene. So next type of polymer is made up of vinyl chloride. Suppose if you have CH double bond CH, add on chlorine to this, the single bond chlorine, vinyl chloride. So this vinyl chloride once again undergo a polymerization. This is called as a polymerization, form a macromolecule called as polyvinyl chloride. PVC we call it as PVC. So used in PVC pipes, all those things. So this, what I am going to tell you is that whenever a organic compounds like ethylene, vinyl chloride and propylene, they are unsaturated one. When they are undergo with the help of catalyst and temperature pressure, that is polymerization, they form a saturated macromolecules which are called as polymers. Polymers are also known as macromolecules. That is a polymer. Here in this slide I am showing this monomers, which are single molecules. They undergo polymerization to form a polymer. Classification of polymers. Polymers are classified on the base of source from which they are getting, and based on the structure of polymers, and based on the mode of polymerization, and based on molecular forces. So based on the source, we have different polymers such as synthetic polymers and natural polymer, and then semi-synthetic polymer. This is natural polymer, which is obtained in nature. Synthetic polymers are those which are made by chemical reactions, which are such as polyethylene fiber and Buna rubber. Semi-synthetic polymers are those which are natural polymers are made chemically, another polymer called as a semi-synthetic polymer. The next one is, based on the structure, we have linear polymers, branch chain polymers, and cross-linked or network polymers. So based on the structure we have done. So here is a linear polymer. You can see linear polymer is formed
by monomers joined with each other and form a long straight chain. These polymers have high melting point. These polymers have high density also, such as polyethylene, polyvinyl chloride, high density polyethylene, etc. Next one is branch chain polymers. You can see in the figure there is a branch in the polymers, the in the monomers joined with each other to form a long straight chain having some branches. These polymers have low melting point and these polymers have very high density. Next one, cross-linked network polymers. So you can see in the diagram that how the polymer is formed by having their cross-link. So bifunctional and trifunctional monomers contain this. So this is example is bakelite and melanin. Based on the mode of polymerization, how the polymerization takes place, we can see there are two types of polymers, that is addition polymers and condensation polymers. So diagram is showing you, that animation is showing you how addition polymerization takes place. So it's simply the monomers are joined to form a long chain polymer without the elimination of any other byproduct. It forms a addition polymer, which is vinyl chloride and polyvinyl chloride. Next one is this condensation polymerization. So here you can see that along with the formation of a polymer, there is an elimination of a molecule is also taking place. So that forms a like a HCl or NH3 are eliminated. It forms a condensation polymerization or condensation polymers. The classification of polymers based on molecular force. So based on molecular force, there are four types of polymers: elastomers, thermoplastic, thermosetting plastic, and fibers. So in elastomers, the polymers is more elastic in nature and there is less molecular force between the molecules. So example is vulcanized rubber. Next one is thermoplastic, which is having the less, not so less molecular force, but not so high molecular force. It is in between, there is a between molecular force between thermoplastic, thermosetting plastic, and elastomers. Elastomers are having less molecular force, thermosetting plastic are having more molecular force. In between these two molecular force, this thermoplastics comes. So they are softened on heating and become hardened on cooled. These polymers do not have any cross bonds. Polyethylene and polystyrene are the examples of this thermoplastic. I have shown in the diagram polyethylene and PVC. Next one is thermosetting plastic. It is having more molecular force than the thermosetting thermoplastics. So they are semi-fluid substance. These polymers cannot be converted into cannot convert in other shapes by heating. On heating they become hard. On heating they become hard, infusible, because these polymers have cross bonds. So I have shown in the diagram bakelite is a telephone which is made up of this bakelite. So in the second diagram you can see thermoplastic, elastomers, and thermoset plastic. So elastomers are having very less molecular force. Thermoplastics are having little more molecular force, whereas thermosetting plastics are having very high molecular force. So more than these thermoset plastics, fibers are having more molecular force. So nylon 66 is one of the example for the these fibers. Methods of polymerization. Already we have seen there are many methods of polymerization, that is addition polymerization and this condensation polymerization. In addition polymerization is brought by linking together simple unsaturated molecules such as alkenes, example ethylene, as I have shown it on the board, substituters like alkenes and propylene. And the condensation polymerization, during this the polymerization takes place, link together with different monomer molecules along with the liberation of a molecule such as water and NH3. So different polymers use as an application. So polythene, as we have used for making carry bags, packing materials, toys, tubes, domestic appliances. Polyvinyl chloride, made up of vinyl chloride, as I told, is used in making cables, helmets, seat covers, belts, drainage pipes, conveyors, belts, dolls, etc. Polystyrene is another polymer which is made up of styrene, used to make jugs, plates, toys, radio, television, cabinets. Bakelite is also used for the same purpose, which is a thermosetting plastic. So rubber is elastomer, as you are told. It is a type of polymer which is used for making tubes, cycle tubes, automobile tubes, floor tiles, adhesives, aircraft components. And polyvinyl acetate, used as a adhesive and latex paints. Again, nylon is a textile. Teflon is used as a non-stick coating for the cooking vessels. These are some of the uses of polymers. So in polymers, we should know, or we should understand the meaning of polymers and type of polymers. Only listing the type of polymers is sufficient, and different uses of polymers. Our next topic is composite materials. So composite materials, here we are going to study the definition of composite materials and the use of different types of composite materials, advantages and disadvantages of these composite materials. So composite materials are made since from very long back, and for example, when you add cement with water and sand, it becomes a composite material. So composite material is having two or more separate components. So one of the component is called as a matrix, and another one is called as a filler. Matrix is a component that holds the filler together to form the bulk of material. Depending on the matrix, the filler composite materials are classified as. Here in the diagram, you can see there is a matrix and fillers. So matrix holds the filler to form a composite material. As I told, for example, cement is a matrix and sand is a filler. The cement is holding this sand to form a composite material. There are many types of composite materials. So some of the types are lightweight composite materials, which are used in automotive industries. Lighter, stronger, wear resistance, that means they do not wear, and they are rust free, and they are looking good also, which is aesthetic. So they are used in making car bodies, brake pads, drive shafts, fuel tanks, etc. So other type of composite material is aerospace composite, used in aerospace industries because it is lighter, stronger, temperature resistant, smart structure, and wear resistance. It is used in aircrafts to make the nose of the aircraft, doors, such things. And rockets and missiles are also made from this aerospace material composite. Of course, satellites also we use the aerospace composite. And unidirectional composite is another type of composite, which once again very lighter, stronger, and toughness, better aesthetic, higher damping properties. Therefore, it is used in making tennis, bicycle, badminton, boats, hockey, golfing, motorcycles, etc. Fiber reinforced composite is a in which fiber is used, and that use very much stronger to the strong to this fiber. So it is having high tough and high damping. So railway coaches, bridges, ships and boats can be constructed. Composite FRP is used in industrial sectors. So the advantages of composite material is that it is already shown that it is light and it's having a high strength related to weight, and it is corrosion resistant. Composite resists damage from weather and form harsh chemical, and that can be eaten away by other materials. So high impact strength is also there for the composite materials. So part of consolidation, a single piece made up of composite material can replace an entire assembly of material parts, reducing the number of parts in machines or a structure, saves time and cuts down the maintenance needed over a long time. And dimensional stability, non-conductive, non-magnetic, radar transparent. Radar transparent means radar signals pass right through these composite materials. The property that makes the composite ideal material for the use anywhere radar equipment is operating, whether on ground or in air. And they have low thermal conductivity. That is the advantages of this composite materials. So with the so much of advantages, we have some of the disadvantage of composite materials also. They become more brittle compared, thus they are easily damaged. So they can be easily damaged. So they have become more metal. As you see, the cabinets of the computers or telephones, they are all made up of composite materials. So once they are break, they break very easily. So repair of such materials is very difficult. So we cannot repair them. They cannot be added. They cannot be welded. Therefore, their repair is difficult. High material and manufacturing cost. The material manufacturing cost is very high. That is another disadvantage of composite material. So there is having a temperature limitation also. So while using this composite material, we should think of the temperature limitations also. Most composite materials are non-degradable also. That is another disadvantage of composite materials. The next topic is solutions. This is our last topic. Solutions. Solutions is the next topic where we are going to study definition of solute, solvent and solution, saturated, unsaturated solution, concentration of solution, that is normality, molarity, molality of solution. These are the things we are going to study in this solution. So solution means it comes like comes to our mind that it is a liquid. So liquid in which some other compound, some other material is added to form a solution. So in chemistry, a solution is a homogeneous mixture composed of two or more substances. In such a mixture, a solute is a substance dissolved in other substance like solvent. For example, in making saline water solution, the dissolving table salt in water, we dissolve table salt in water. Salt is a solute and water is a solvent. So the solution in which the material is dissolved is called as a solute, and the solution and the liquid is called as a solvent. There are two types of solutions, unsaturated solution and saturated solution. An unsaturated solution is a chemical solution in which the solute concentration is lower than the equilibrium solubility. All the solute dissolve in solvent. Suppose if you take 1 liter of water and add few grams of salt in it, so that is capable of accepting more salt. So that solution becomes an unsaturated solution because we can add some more salt to it to become a solution. So unsaturated solution is a solution in which the solute concentration is lower than the equilibrium solubility. And saturated solution is the solution containing the maximum concentration of solute dissolved in solvent. Addition of solute will not dissolve. So you can see here, solubility, you can see in the two test tubes, we have taken in one test tube unsaturated solution, in the another test tube a saturated solution. So unsaturated solution, more solute dissolve. So that means we can add some more solute to the unsaturated solution. Whereas in saturated solution, no more solute can be added to dissolve. These are the two types of solution. So a solution, the concentration of solution is relationship between the solvent and the concentration of solution, solvent and the solute. The relation between solute and the solvent gives the concentration of solution. There are three types of concentration, that is normality, molarity and molality. So based on the amount of solvent and amount of solution that is used, we have three types of solutions. In normal solution, the normality of a solution is the gram equivalent weight of solute per liter of solution. It may also called equivalent concentration. So 1 gram of equivalent weight of solution per liter of solution is called as, per solute is called as normal solution. Normality of a solution is gram equivalent weight of solute per liter. So gram equivalent of weight of solute we take, we dissolve in 1 liter of solution, then it will become a normal solution. So the symbol of normal solution is N. Next one is the equivalent weight of equivalent value is determined using molecular weight and valence of the chemical species. Normality is the only concentration unit that is reaction depends. So normality can be calculated as the ratio of equivalent weight of solution to liters of solution. Normality of solution can also be expressed in terms of mass and equivalent mass. Mass of the solute into 1000, that is 1 liter, divided by equivalent of the solute into volume of the solution in ml is to use to calculate the normality. Next, molar solution or molarity. Molarity M is defined as number of moles. We are taking here number of moles. There in normality we are taking number of grams. So we are taking number of moles of solute dissolved in 1 liter of solution. So number of moles if you take, it will become molarity. So molarity is calculated as the ratio of mass of the solute into 1000 divided by volume of solution. So molar solution or molarity is the same thing like molality is same thing like molarity. So in molarity we are taking the number of moles in dissolved in 1 liter of solution, whereas in molality we take molality of solution is defined as number of moles solute per kilogram. There in molarity we are taking dissolved in 1 liter of solution, number of moles dissolved in 1 liter of solution. In molality we are taking number of mole dissolved in 1 kg of solvent. This is molarity, molality. Molality can also be calculated as the ratio of moles of solute into 1000 divided by mass of the solvent in kg. This is all about solutions we are studying. So we have studied all the topics that are there in industrial chemistry except electrolysis, corrosion and PH. We have studied the basic things about batteries, fuel cells, then metallurgy, polymers, composite materials, and then this solutions. So I think this much of information is sufficient for you about these topics. Thank you for listening to my lecture patiently.